welcome. Thanks all for coming today to what promises to be a really interesting and rich discussion on our topic, ideology after the end of ideologies. I would like to thank all the sponsors of the event today, Princeton University and the Department for the Study of Modern Czech Philosophy and the Department of Contemporary Continental Philosophy here at the Academy of Sciences in Prague. It's always a great pleasure and an honor to welcome our esteemed friend and colleague, Etienne Balibar, who's joining us here this morning. And Etienne's work, I'm sure, is familiar to all of us and needs no introduction. He is Professor Emeritus of Moral and Political Philosophy at the Université de Paris 10, Nanterre, and he's a distinguished professor of the humanities at the University of California, Irvine. Columbia? Columbia University, Kingston.
Visiting.
Yes, visiting everywhere in demand. We know many, many of his works, beginning with his very famous, well-known contribution to reading Capital, Lire le Capital from 1965 with Louis Althusser and other colleagues. And since then, so many works that he has published, Spinoza in Politics, Race, Nation, Class with Emmanuel Wallerstein, Politics and the Other Scene, these are some of the English translations, Identity and Difference, John Locke and the Invention of Consciousness, The Philosophy of Marx, Equal Liberty, and a fairly recent work of his, Violence and Civility on the Limits of Political Philosophy, that's currently under translation.
No, it's here.
Okay. Here in the Czech Republic.
Excuse me, I should not correct you all the time.
And it should be coming out later this
thank
year.
Thank you, thank you. I'm very grateful for that.
And coming soon. And so we're looking forward to that appearing here in Czech. And so it's again, a great honor to welcome Etienne Balibar, who will speak on our topic, ideology after the end of ideologies. Etienne.
Thank you, Nick. I guess I need to use that mic, although I hate these instruments. Can you hear me in the rear? Yes? Should I speak? That's enough? You're very far away. I can barely see you, but...
Don't worry.
Okay. Nick, how much time do you give me? 45 minutes?
45 yes? minutes is fine.
With discussion? Without discussion?
Plus discussion.
Plus discussion. Yeah. Good. Okay. Okay.
Yes,
I have my notes, so I can adapt. I can adjust. First thing I want to say is it's an enormous pleasure and a great honor to be here this morning, taking part in this extremely exciting conference, and returning to Prague for the first time after almost 30 years, which is unbelievable in a sense, but this is due to many circumstances which we can talk about later. Okay, so when I would have accepted the invitation, of course, on coming from you and coming from Nick and coming from Peter, where is he? Peter Kuzel. An old colleague and friend who came to Paris to visit me on almost any subject, of course, if I could say something about it. But this one, no doubt, was especially exciting and intriguing. And when beginning to think how I could try and address the question or the questions that are involved in the title, I soon realized that there were many difficulties, not to say traps, hiding behind this, of course, intentionally paradoxical formulations. And in fact, I am very curious to see how the topic will be addressed progressively along the day. So my attempt this morning as a kind of introduction will be to communicate to you my own reactions on this topic, which of course are heavily influenced by the kind of cultural and philosophical background that I have. So the first idea that comes to mind is what kind of paradox is involved here, or what is the answer that the paradox tries to suggest. And of course, as we all realize, ideology after the end of ideology in the singular, I will return to that singular, could suggest that there are two opposite possibilities. Either it's a way of suggesting that ideology never ends, so that any declared end of ideologies is in a sense a denial or a kind of of performative contradiction, if you like. And so therefore ideology would be like the real in some contemporary discourses. It always returns. And then the question is, of course, does it return in the same form, or does it return in the same place, or in the same function? All these terms are partially equivalent, but not always equivalent. But then we also immediately see that this could be understood, so to speak, from the other side in a reverse manner. That is, the very essence of ideology would be to end, which of course leads to the ambiguities of the notion of ending in many of our languages, particularly in English. So under the name of ideology, we should think of something that is either never stable, never identical to itself, never able to become fixed and located, or attributed a specific and, so to speak, identical place and function. This is not not only this is not an absurd idea. Of course, it should inevitably lead to questioning the kind of latent ontology that we have in mind when we use such formulas. But in the case of ideology, I don't know if during the day, perhaps, probably, at least some aspects of the history of the name ideology will be coming into the discussion and will be reflected upon. But the very least that we can indicate already at the beginning, because this is something that we more or less all have in mind, and I'll return to some of its consequences, is not only the fact that ideology, at least initially, was and remained for a negative term, so that to declare that discourses or thoughts or ideas are ideological, in a sense, immediately involves a kind of, hello, Jean Godefroy, involves a kind of negative attitude, so which you could also describe using such formulas as ideology is always the ideology of the other. Which is not to say that there are no possibilities to say, here is my ideology, here's my ideological standpoint. But this, in a sense, is a reaction to a first move, which is to criticize what is called ideology. And from the idea of criticizing ideology to the idea, to which I will come in a second, of explaining why ideology should not exist, or why ideology is bound to become overcome or somehow destroyed, the distance is not so long. So that the idea that under the name of ideology we always refer to something that is elusive and in fact in the course of ending one way or another, there's not such a big distance. And of course you can also push the paradox to far enough to contain both meanings at the same time, which directs our attention to the very equivocity or equivocality of the notion of end in philosophy and more generally in common language in our discourse, involving a contradictory unity, I would say, of termination and culmination, if you want. Well, so the second reason why I perceived, and I'm sure this is banal, I mean, I'm not the only one who say that, is that it seems to me, so I propose this, of course, as a not as an absolute starting point, but a kind of inevitable preliminary to the discussion, for the discussion of today. In fact, there is another latent duality, I would say, in the formula, which comes from the fact that the title of the conference uses both the singular and the plural. So you will say, you're cutting, splitting hairs, what are you doing with that? But I immediately thought that I was wondering, I was asking myself, why did they call it ideology in the singular after the end of ideologies in the plural? How about again reversing the formulas, ideologies in the plural, which ideologies, which ideological discourses of many different kinds that we can try and bring under this name, after the end of ideology in the singular, which of course suggests a more radical, I would say, quasi-transcendental, if you allow me this formula, understanding of the term. And of course this, having this in mind, or perhaps this is my way of addressing this kind of issues, suggested to me that we should return to the very origin, historical, I mean, in a strictly philological and positivist, so to say, understanding of the of this formula, very origin of this phrase, I would say, of this kind of statement. There is an end to ideology, or there is an end of ideologies. So where does that come from? So my guess, I'm not 100% sure of that, we'd have to, if you have other information or suggestions, I'm of course keen to take them, is the formula was either invented or became popularized when, in 1960, an American sociologist and a philosopher, you might say, called Daniel Bell, published a book that soon became famous. In French, it was translated long after the event, but it had already penetrated through different channels. Same, I believe, in other languages, probably not in Czech for obvious reasons, but that is something you can retrieve retrospectively, with the title The End of Ideology in the Singular or The Exhaustion of Political Ideas in the 1950s. Of course, we have not much time, but it's very interesting, of course, to propose a summary and considerations about that book. Even if you don't go to the text itself, you'll find many references and summaries in the vast literature. Now, of course, Daniel Bell's book was a part of a broader array, I would say, of philosophical and political critiques of the so-called totalitarian discourses of the East, that is really existing socialism and its official doctrine, Marxism, which at the time, of course, enjoyed a worldwide acceptance with many internal splits and conflicts, both in the old world, the new world, and the third world, and was widely perceived, if not as hegemonic, at least as a kind of ascending discourse, political discourse. And Bell was who himself, like many other spokespersons or figures, I would say, of this critical discourse in the West, very often associated not only with universities, but also think tanks and, in fact, propaganda, I would say, which is not to say that he's stupid, much the contrary. Propaganda agencies linked to the CIA, which was also the case of people like James Burnham, whom I will perhaps refer to a little later, the author of The Managerial Revolution. They very often had a Marxist background themselves, particularly in as much as they had belonged to Marxist groups in the United States in the 30s in particular. So during the initial period of the ideological struggles in the US linked to the Great Crisis. And so some of them were Trotskyists, but this is a secondary issue. I will return to this in a second because I want to suggest that Daniel Bell was in a sense turning against Marxism, ideas that came from Marxism itself, including perhaps the very idea of the end of ideologies. A constitutive part of this discourse was to explain that the power, the capacity of the hegemonic or virtually hegemonic capacity of Marxism, and more generally revolutionary anti-capitalist and anti-liberal ideas, were in fact bound to end soon, which gave, of course, that discourse retrospectively an extraordinary quality of conviction, of demonstration. They very much anticipated what took place later, in fact, in 1989 in Europe and the years immediately after. So that if you combine this this declaration or this publication with a series of other texts, you produce something like a chain, I would say, not only a signifying a chain, but a discursive chain, which acquired over the time perhaps even greater relevance than it had initially possessed. And I would include in that series, as I said, Burnham's The Managerial Revolution, a fundamental text, the one that was published in its first version in 1949, explaining that ideological differences, so the intention is slightly different, the conflict, the visible conflict between the liberal discourse on one side and the Marxist discourse on the other side, is a superficial discursive level, behind which what is taking place is a material transformation and a social transformation of societies and economies, both East and West, whereby, in fact, the logic of industrial organization and management and the coming to power of the manager, the managing classes, I mean the class, who are neither workers, of course, nor capitalists in the classical sense, is becoming the central social characteristic, something that had become extremely popular in the West in particular, where I was, but also in the East. There were varieties of that in the socialist camp at the time of the so-called peaceful coexistence in the 60s, which also was deemed to include a kind of deep level convergence of political systems. So if you add to that Karl Popper's The Open Societies, Society and Its Enemies in 1945, which insists more on the democratic aspect than the industrial or economic one, you get the trilogy, I would say, of proposals which finds its coronation, so to speak, after the political revolutions in destroying or suppressing socialist regimes in Europe, and is being expressed famously in Francis Fukuyama's book with the title The End of History and the Last Man. So I proposed, I have to accelerate, but I propose this line to explain that there is in fact a latent question concerning the relationship between the two ideas, the end of ideology and the end of history, which in many respects is what I want to try and address here. So I've been too long on that preliminary, so I have to cut a little bit now. So the first thing I want to say, always as a matter of introduction, is to specify or highlight some questions which are some more theoretical questions that are latent, if you like, in this description.
Yes. We have plenty of time.
No. Yes, perhaps 5 minutes, but you know me, I'm extremely dangerous. Some people here know my propensity to talk and say nothing for hours. Okay, so the first question that I want to ask is the one I indicated just a little minute ago. To what extent is the idea or this statement, if you like, which is at the same time assertive and performative, already something interesting, the end of ideology is taking place, the end of ideology is bound to come and to arrive, a kind of reversal of a Marxist discourse itself. And I think that this becomes fairly obvious and likely, if you like, not only because of the personal trajectory or the intellectual formation of those theorists who invented the expression and therefore handed it over to us in a sense. So one of the possible meanings, of course, of our title could be something like the end of ideologies was openly declared in the 1960s. It became verified in a sense in 1989 and later. And where are we now? I mean, it's so, but there is another side to that, which is which are the roots of this idea in Marxism itself. And so here, this would be, of course, a very long story, but I will assume that you have, that we all have in mind certain classical texts, and particularly those texts in Marx himself that rely, I would say, on the twin antitheses, and they are practically synonymous in some contexts, of being and consciousness. So in German, that would be Sein and Bewusstsein, which includes, of course, an ontological assumption that is more perceptible than in the English. And on the other hand, history and ideology. So the latent assumption that you find, the latent, I mean, the explicit assumption that you find in Marx's German ideology, the great philosophical essay and book that remained unpublished, that but that later Marx and Engels never ceased to refer to and to quote from and to apply in their general philosophical considerations, is that ideology is to history like consciousness, Bewusstsein, is to being, that is, Sein. Or in other terms, when being becomes history, or the essential form of being or reality, if you like, is historical reality, then the typical form that consciousness takes with respect to that kind of being is ideology. Okay, something that is confirmed, as we know, by very well-known formulas, which include, of course, the critical dimension, such as explained at length in the German ideology, repeated in a concise and striking manner in the preface to the 1859 critique of political economy. Just as you do not judge an individual's behavior or real behavior on his or her consciousness, you do not judge the reality, you do not explain the real structures, the historical transformations of a society after its ideology, which is in fact a form of collective consciousness. And the consequence of that, as we know in Marx's presentation, or the epistemological consequence of that, is twofold. On the one side, the idea that will be taken up again by various Marxists, particularly Althusser, to whom I come in a minute, that ideology has no history. Of course, this is an extremely ambiguous and ambivalent formula. It doesn't mean, at least in the first place or at prima facie, that there are never changes in the ideological realm, but it means something like the history of ideology is not determined from the inside. because in a sense the being of that consciousness, the sein of that bewusstsein, lies outside of its own realm or plane, I would say, of appearances in the real history, the transformation of the mode of production and other similar things in a sense. And the reverse consequence, of course, is you have to place yourself, so to speak, to find a place, an intellectual place, a vantage point, I would say, a kind of Archimedean vantage point to study the real history of the society that would be outside of the ideological realm. And of course, this is immediately appears as something extremely paradoxical in a sense, at least if you keep adopting or maintaining this equivalence between ideology and consciousness, because of course that would involve that somehow the vantage point that you need to adopt is unconscious or is outside consciousness, or is a form of consciousness that involves the negation of all the typical characteristics of consciousness itself. Now, as we know, this leads Marx himself to juxtaposing permanently two different kinds of phenomenologies, I would say, concerning this point. So I looked for philosophical categories that would picture them as clearly as possible. I decided myself for, on the one side, separation, so the primary operation that makes it possible to produce a critique of ideology is a separation, and therefore the field within which this separation is taking place that becomes split is something like discourse or language, or in the Hegelian manner, it is supersession, Aufhebung, we would say in German. This second scheme is the one that is most developed by Marx in the early text, the German ideology in particular, but it is also the one that becomes increasingly difficult to apply to, I would say, political, to make use of in a political context, because it is the one that relies, this is very clear in the German ideology, on the idea that what produces ideology or ideological representations and discourses is the fact that individuals only access, individuals or groups, he sometimes says parties, classes, access to a partial view of the social structure and the general history. Hence the idea that you find in the German ideology that the course of history, the teleology, in fact, of the development of history is one in which viewpoints that remained partial and represented, perhaps this is a play on words, a partial interest, which you can also call a class interest, become progressively universalized and in fact generalized. So that in the end, this is the discourse of the German ideology, when each and every individual has been put in communication with each and every other individual on the surface of the earth because of the progressive transformation of the division of labor and the economic structure, then ideology will no longer have any function and in fact will disappear. So from there, of course, we can see why it was so easy, in a sense, for an explicitly, this is not to apply to it in a pejorative viewpoint, an explicitly anti-Marxist discourse could rely in fact, on a Marxist or quasi-Marxist logic, because the implicit idea would be that, contrary to its hopes and its pretension, Marxism or revolutionary Marxism or socialism, if you prefer, would not represent in the end the point of view of the totality or the point of view of the fully developed division of labor and economic structures of modernity, of the modern world, but still, nevertheless, in fact, a partial viewpoint and a specific class interest, from which you can return very quickly to the consideration of Daniel Bell's discourse. If you look at, I'm not ashamed of quoting this kind of source, if you look at the Wikipedia presentation of Daniel Bell, which is very limited, I mean, it's not very rich, you find a declaration that they attribute to him, which of course I'm not able to verify, but that sounds rather likely, in which it's an indirect quote. It is said that Daniel Bell described himself as a socialist in economics, a liberal in politics, and a conservative in culture, which is a very nice and interesting way of suggesting that the time of totalization or overcoming partial and therefore antithetic views of the world has come, and which is also interesting, I don't know if I'll have time to expand on that, because it refers to a tripartition, a trilogy of modern or ideologies in the plural, which is also, of course, adopted and made use of by other authors, specifically Emmanuel Wallerstein, who was quoted a moment ago, to whom I want to refer in a minute. Now, more rapidly on those points, on those preliminary points, I referred a moment ago to the very close, I would say, association of the two themes, end of ideology and end of history. Again, the ambivalence here is extremely interesting because you always have the two possibilities: to declare that the end of history somehow has come because ideologies are exhausted, suggesting that what we call history, or what a certain tradition that can be both socialist, conservative, or liberal, called history, was in fact an ideological representation. For example, the ideological representation of progress, or the inevitability of conflicts and revolution in history, so that when this ideological moment is exhausted, history in that sense, itself ideological, of course, is no longer a meaningful representation. This is the Kojevian or quasi or pseudo-Kojevian representation that is used by Fukuyama. But of course, you can also make a reverse use of that, which is to explain that the theme of the end of history, and again with the full ambiguity of end, I mean culmination and in fact suppression or transformation, is a typical ideological representation, and in fact all great classical ideologies are one way or another a way of anticipating, forecasting, and imagining, I will return to that, something like an end of history. Whether that end of history is called market, is called rational state, or is called communism and final revolution. Now that leads, of course, to another very interesting theme, which I'm sure will surface again one way or another during this conference, which is the Lyotardian way of understanding post-modernity, the idea of the end of the great narratives. So between Lyotard and Bell, there is a tension, but there is also an affinity. In fact, Bell reacted later rather critically about the Lyotardian theme of the end of the great narratives, but essentially because he believed that this would be implicitly, and this is not a wrong way to understand it, a kind of skeptical theme which contain doubts, if you like, about the narrative of the triumphant democracy and or industrial democracy itself. In any case, this shows that at the roots of all these permanent, I hope this doesn't give you the impression that I want to have every formula being reversible, but at the root of all that is a great assimilation, I would say, between ideology, utopia, and eschatology, and eschatology. And of course, this is something that we are bound to pay a great attention again today, because if you ask yourself, and you'll read this all around us, about what it practically means to officially, so to speak, declare the end of utopias and eschatologies in one way or another, either from a Marxist standpoint, as it used to be the case in the past, or from a liberal or neoliberal standpoint, as it's more the case today, what you get to, I will put it brutally and simply, is Margaret Thatcher's famous formula, there is no alternative, which most people translate or express in the form, at least in French, TINA, T-I-N-A, T-I-N-A. So, and of course, this leads also to the, so this leads to different kinds of both constatations, I would say, worries and interrogations. One of them, I'm especially sensitive to that these days, and I was reading again in the press these very last days in the French press attempts by, I think, very intelligent and good sociologists and historians of religions about the rules, the roots of Islamic terrorism and other similar nihilistic kinds of anti-Western, sometimes, yes, it's not anti-capitalist, but anti-Western violence. You read such things as when there is no longer a utopia, when there are no longer political utopias, or alternatively eschatologies, or you might want to put that also in the categories extremely useful in this debate, I believe, which are another variety of the discussion about the end of ideology that were proposed in the same period, in the a little later, in the late 60s, by Reinhard Koselleck, in terms of horizons of expectation, Erwartungshorizonten. So when there is no longer an Erwartungshorizont, or something that you can formulate as a final goal, therefore a cause to which, an ideological cause to which to commit yourself and dedicate yourself, then the consequences are not peace, prosperity, democracy, liberty and equality for all, but in fact extreme violence and nihilistic behaviors from the part of individuals or groups. So that the end of ideology, which was meant initially in terms of putting an end to totalitarianism, seems to open the gate for terror. But of course, this is not the only possible way of understanding things. It also suggests that at some point in our recent history, and we are there probably, the moment when it could be asserted with some very similitude or likelihood that end of ideology would be more or less synonymous with entering an era, or an era is perhaps even not the good term because it seems to include a periodization of philosophy of history, but a situation, a world in a sense of normality and rationality has become incredibly shaky and problematic itself. At the end of which we find us, of course, with a kind of I would say, we say in French, match nul, dead.
A draw
between the two philosophies of history, the Marxist, the classical Marxist, and the liberal or neo-liberal, sometimes also conservative view. Okay, so I will have to skip different things because I'm later and later in my program. So I will skip the reference to Wallasey, but I seriously and sincerely suggest that you examine his way of discussing this issue. You will find, so when I was organizing a seminar in Paris in the 90s with Wallasey, we once chose a theme which he had suggested the title for. That was the three ideologies. But then he proposed a more refined version of the idea that you will find in different essays, especially the introductory chapter to the last volume published. It's not the last in the plan. I don't know if he will finish. This is not essential, of the great and big history of the modern world system, which is called Liberalism Triumphant. It's on the 19th century period when modern industrial capitalism becomes the dominant mode of production in the world. And there you will find still, I say just one quick thing on that idea in its most explicit form, which I find very convincing. Of course, it's directed at ideology in the sense of political discourse and political program. So it's ideology from the point of view of the permanent struggle between different political programs typical of the mature capitalist era. Wallerstein's idea, which I find very convincing, is twofold. On the one hand, so this is a quasi or post-Marxist presentation, he explains that the combination of the two revolutions that took place almost simultaneously, and of course whose combination already was at the root of Marx's analysis of modernity in the Communist Manifesto, namely the political revolution, typically the French but also the American, based on the introduction of constitutional systems in which citizens are at least officially free and equal individuals and not members of corporations and so become individualized. And on the other hand, the Industrial Revolution, which introduces the proper capitalist or developed capitalist mode of production, produced a cultural effect. So he says cultural, where other Marxists, Althusser in particular, would probably say ideology in the primary sense of the term, that is the immediate, if you like, mode of appearance of social processes and social phenomena for the consciousness of its own agents. Now, what's interesting in Wallerstein's presentation is the fact that for him, this kind of always already given evidence or obviousness entails the idea that change is necessary. The absolute opposite of what traditional societies would take for granted, namely that essentially, even if there are troubles, even if there are conflicts and vicissitudes and oscillation, the course of time is an eternal return of the same. What becomes obvious with the bourgeois era is just the opposite. It's the fact that things will never be the same over time. They're bound to change. And therefore, the three ideologies that he identifies, and he's right in suggesting that the very names of these ideologies, together with the category ideology itself, are born exactly in that period, in the immediate, in the two or three first decades of the 19th century, liberalism, conservatism, and socialism, of which Marxism, of course, will be a part, are essentially, and to begin with, ways of managing change, or handling change, or reacting to the fact that history means change. And therefore, of course, you have different attitudes. You can either try to obstacle that change, resist the change, or you can try and implement the change, or you can try and accelerate the change and push the change beyond its immediate results and forms. But then the second aspect, which is equally important, and it is on that basis that Wallerstein proposes to very provocatively perform, I would say, a progressive reduction of 3-2 and finally 3-1, or 3-2 and then 2-1, has to do with the fact that all these ideologies share the same basic internal paradox, namely the fact that they locate the necessity and also, of course, the consequences, the perils or the good sides of change in something that they call society, which is supposed to be independent from the state or what Marx would call the superstructure. So the change is a change in customs, it's a change in family forms, it's a change in property forms, of course, essentially, in the change of modes of production. This is the essential core. And therefore, in a sense, what you have to do is abstract from the seeming or apparent force and decisive character of the state. But then all three ideologies, in fact, reverse their initial pattern and take the form, because they are political programs, of trying to use the state in order to produce within society the social effect that for them is desirable. So, of course, dictatorship of the proletariat in the Marxist case is a perfect illustration of that. But even in liberal discourse, you have exactly the same. And this keeps being the case, of course, all the more in the current period of neoliberal discourse, because the mantra of that discourse is we need to use the state in order to eliminate the obstacles that institutions and political movements oppose, in fact, to the logic of the irrational market, which leads us again to the same point as before, namely the idea that the symmetry between, I would say, the liberal discourse of the end of ideology and the Marxist discourse of the end of ideology is extremely strong, except that, of course, what is described in the Marxist tradition as a progressive dissolution of political illusions, and this is explicit in the Communist Manifesto, the workers, the proletarians do no longer believe in those illusions, religion, nation, or patriotism, moral ideas, and so on. What Marx relates to the dissolution of property, of private property, in the case of the proletariat, is on the other hand, in the tradition of liberal discourse, typically represented or based on the idea that property becomes progressively generalized, and that is, ceases to be a monopoly of a certain part of the society. Of course, that seems to be difficult to argue in some cases, but thinking more about it, there are many ways of explaining that that everybody becomes a private owner. One of them, of course, is the idea that you can buy shares of this or that pension fund, and even you need to do it. And this is true, or this will become true for anybody, including third world absolute paupers, which in a sense is ridiculous. But there's a more sophisticated version of that, which is extremely, of course, influential and powerful. This is human capital. This is the absolutization and generalization of the idea that already lied at the root of the classical description of wage labor, namely the idea that modern people who work, sell their labor force, are not slaves because they own something, and in a sense they have a duty to produce the best. I mean, to make the most productive use of that property that in any case they must retain, and which is the property in their own person or their property in their own capacities. So the two discourses again are almost reciprocal. Okay, so I will end this. I had many other many other. Thank you for giving me a little bit of time. This, which I repeat, are kinds of ruminations that came to my mind in the beginning, leaving aside many things that could be associated with that. With a return to Althusser, I know that some people here are fond of his, are in the course of rereading his work, and I do it myself inevitably because we are in the 50th anniversary of the publication of Reading Capital, as you mentioned, and I was part of that with others, with many others. And some of the aporias, the very visible aporias of Althusser's thinking that have been addressed again and again, sometimes very productively from different angles. I'm particularly thinking of Judith Butler's attempt at taking up again and revising, in fact, very and criticizing from the inside Althusser's notion of the interpolation of individuals as subjects, as the typical ideological effect. This keeps the idea somehow working. And it occurred to me that we might try to do a different use of these ideas. And I was also pushed in that direction by the very interesting fact that a young colleague of ours, a Greek philosopher who wrote a dissertation with Alain Badiou, I believed, and worked at the University of Paris 8 in the last period, called Maria Kakogiani, had a very intelligent idea, I believe, which I'm eager to take up. Her paper was published in French, at least, in Actuel Marx. She said, what we need to do is complement, or perhaps supersede, that's the whole issue, Althusser's notion of the ideological state apparatuses, ISAs, with a new and different idea, which is the idea of the, so she called it in French, appareil idéologique de marché, the market, the ISA, ideological market apparatuses. So whether you can use that symmetry or not is the whole question. Now, returning for a second to Althusser's formulations, I will remind you what I already said, and I'm very quick on that, that Althusser typically wants to understand ideology not as a one layer, so to speak, or univocal structure, but as permanently a kind of double or twofold or two-layered structure, which of course gives him a possibility, elegant, I would say, if not convincing, to address the issue of the singular and the plural. Because the plural would be located at, I would say, the level of discourse. There are, of course, many conflicting ideological discourses. And whereas the singular is located at the level of what I called a moment ago the primary process, the one that has to do in Althusser's formulation, not with representing social relations, but with living within or perceiving from the inside the social relations of which you are the bearers or the agents. Hence the famous formula that Althusser repeatedly made use of with slight variations. Ideology is not the representation of social relations, not the Bewusstsein, if you like, corresponding to a certain sein, the discourse corresponding to a reality, as in the classical Marxist formula, but it is the representation of the subject's relation to their own real conditions of existence, or their relation to another system of relations. And then, of course, comes what is widely considered to be Althusser's difficult point, or perhaps weakness in his, or logical weakness in his description of this, which also some interpreters try to introduce or incorporate in the concept itself as a kind of internal trope. You know, the idea that ideology always already presupposes its own existence, which is very much what Judith Butler does. Now, the difficulty comes from the fact, I would say very quickly, that the most basic layer or element, the element, if you like, of life world, we would say in phenomenological terminology, or imagination in the Spinozistic sense of the term, that precedes and determines or always already conditions a discourse, a conflictual, a partisan discourse, and that is shared in a sense by all the members of the same society, however antagonistic or antithetic their positions are, is called by Althusser eternal. So he derives this formula, as you know, from two sources. On the one hand, there is Marx's paradoxical formula, to which I referred a moment ago, in the German ideology. Ideology has no history, But on the other side, there is the Freudian, the analogy, the problematic analogy between the structure and the working of ideology in a Marxist or post-Marxist sense, and the Freudian description of mechanisms of the unconscious and the production of fantasies, namely the idea of permanent repetition of the same, or return of the same to the same place. Now this leads, in Althusser's case, of course, to the famous idea that there will be no end of ideology. This is an absurdity, this is a contradiction in terms, because to suggest that there could be an end of ideology in the primary sense is tantamount to suggesting that individuals will not perceive, will not need to perceive the social conditions in which they live, which produce their own relations. But of course, this is not to say that the ideologies will always be the same. And then when Althusser wants to isolate that sort of core or typical mechanism of primary ideologization of subjects or socialization of subjects, which essentially is the same, he brings in this little scheme, dramatic scheme of the interpolation. And as many readers have been keen of noticing, and you can either make a very brutal and blunt use of that, or you can elaborate the critique in a sophisticated way, the interpolation has models which are historical themselves. They're absolutely not innocent models. They are religious on the one side and juridical on the other side. God speaking to Moses from the Mount Sinai, and Moses to his people, and so on the one side, and the policeman and the whole legal and system interpolating, that is, first of all, naming, of course, and assigning a responsibility, a personal responsibility to the individual. So that in Althusser's formulation, if you like, the historical itself returns into the eternal, or the anthropological, or the primary process, which seems to involve a rather strange idea for a Marxist, at least, or somebody who claims to be a Marxist. Not only there won't be an end to ideology, but there won't be an end to the state. There won't be an end to the, I would say, theological, juridical core structure of the ideological system. Because otherwise you would not understand how and why individuals can be interpolated. And I leave aside, of course, the important consequence that Butler made a great use of from there, and he was right in my opinion, which is to expand the kind of, I would say, symptomatic lapse in Althusser's presentation, where he alludes to the fact that there is not only interpolation, but there can be counter-interpolation, that is, revolt, of course, rebellion, and turning, so to speak, the ideological against its own social and political function, because that's part of the same mechanism. Now, what's the idea of Maria, and I end with that, The idea of Maria Kakogiani is neoliberalism triumphant, what I'm tempted to call absolute capitalism. Absolute capitalism is not pure capitalism. We do not live in pure capitalism. There's no such thing. Capitalism is, in a sense, permanently a recapitulation of all its previous historical forms. so that in particular you don't have one single form of exploitation, but all of them are simultaneously present. But still, nevertheless, absolute capitalism in the sense of a complete financialization and achieved globalization is a capitalism that has achieved, in a sense, its transition, I would say, from pre-capitalist forms to capitalist forms. And this is very much where we are today. So be very careful when I say this, which seems to be a kind of, discourse a la Fukuyama or something like that. I'm not saying that this situation is stable. I'm not saying that this situation is a kind of end of history itself. I'm just saying that retrospectively, the forms of political, of the institution of the political, and the production of political discourses, which are ideological by definition, that we could observe in the past, including socialism, liberalism, and conservatism, were typical of the era of transition that Marx essentially was involved in. And if you ask the question how individuals are subjected to the kind of order of absolute capitalism, I don't say that Althusser's mechanism of interpolation, religious, juridical, etc., no longer exists. There clearly is another one that is becoming increasingly powerful. And this is the interpolation through the ideological structures of the market itself. Provided you, of course, take into account that the market is aestheticized, the market is combined with media industry and representation. So in a sense, of course, I'm invoking against Althusser himself something that the other wing of Marxism, the Frankfurt School, if you like, developed on the basis of its understanding of commodity fetishism, but trying to push this one step further. To me, the most vivid illustration of that is a place where I have to be all the time, and most of us as well, which increasingly I hate, but I cannot prevent from going there. I can prevent from going to a church. I'm not forced to go to a church. So I'm prevented from feeling, so to speak, the physical presence of the ideological state apparatus as you perceive it when you are in a church or some similar edifice. I had that impression very strongly for the first time in my life when visiting the Cathedral of Toledo in Spain, which is a monster built on the ruins or the destruction of the previous mosques at the time of the Reconquista. You are in that building and you physically feel, so to speak, that your prayer is going up, not to God, but to a very strong stone ceiling from where it falls back on you as a capacity of interpolation. Now, you're not forced to go into the Cathedral of Toledo or the Hadshin, which is more elegant, I have to say, but you're almost forced to go to an airport. And if you go to an airport, you walk through the drives or the corridors that take you to the plane. And on the side of these corridors, you have the advertisement of the banks, and especially the one that obsesses me, HSBC. These are pictures showing everything from animals, fishing, mothers and children, every possible element of life and also dream, of course, with, how do you call that in English, sentences. I mean, there's a technical word in English for that. The
copy text.
The text, yes, but there's a typical word. which state the obvious in the form, the future is already there. All the possibilities are open, and so on and so on. And this is, I believe, the linguistic and communicative element of what Maria Kakogiani very rightly calls the market, the ideological market apparatus, which is an apparatus of communication. And of course, it's a further development, of course, of the fetishism of commodities, in which you not only have, as Marx suggested, the implicit language of the commodities speaking the language of equivalence to one another, but you have a discourse that has been specifically produced to double, so to speak, or to redouble this kind of permanent 24 hours a day immersion within the world of commodities. And of course, this is something that is at the same time very different from what Althusser used to describe, but also, in a sense, at a more abstract level, a kind of interpolation. Not the interpolation by the same type of agency, but interpolation by, in fact, the structures, the very structures of absolute capitalism, which do not coincide with the state or the state society dilemma of the past. Now, I'm not saying that this is the end of ideology, or that this is the new ideology after the end of ideology. I'm rather suggesting that there is a tension between both, and that tension, which perhaps has to be traced back to a kind of structural dilemma, I would say, or structural tension, not only in capitalism, but perhaps in more at a more general anthropological level, is a kind of permanent embodiment, I would say, of the paradox that we have in mind when we ask the question, ideology beyond after the end of ideology. Sorry for abusing in that such horrible manner of your patience and generosity. Thank you, Nick. Thank you all.
Thank you so much, Etienne, for such a rich presentation and start, and so many compelling ideas you've put forward. I'm sure there are many many questions that we have, and I think we have at least 10 or 15 minutes for discussion. If you'll take some questions.
Of course, I'm ashamed that I. If you don't write in advance, you are.
Maybe I can start. I have
two quick questions.
The first one is a comment and a question at the same time. I wonder if I'm very intrigued by the idea that you put out at the end on interpolation by the structures of capitalism as a sort of contemporary predominant dynamic of interpolation. I wonder if we already find something along those lines in Marx himself with the idea of the sujet automate and the ways that the structures of capitalism can, maybe this is making too much out of a small phrase, but is there something in Marx that already suggests that those structures interpolate the subjects necessary to the valorization of value to capitalism itself? My second question is a more general one, maybe that you've addressed but not raised specifically. I wonder how you see today the familiar distinction from the 60s that Althusser and collaborators made between science and ideology. How do you understand today that distinction between, on the one hand, whatever we might understand by ideology and whatever we might understand by what half a century ago you called science or an adequate understanding of social structures?
These are huge questions. I will react briefly because I spoke really too much. But on the first point, the sujet automate, of course, this is a very interesting idea. It has resonances beyond Marx or apart from Marx himself in the history of philosophy. It immediately brings to my mind the Spinozist notion of the automa spirituale, you know, the idea that the chain of ideas and representations is not essentially rooted in a subject's decision or a will, which is not to say that we eliminate the subject, but we see the subject more on the side of the effect than on the side of the cause. So, if what you have in mind is Marx's precisely analysis of the value form and all its progressive expansion, I would say, in the first section of Capital, that later led, of course, some Marxists to even greater development of that. I would say that the yes, of course, the idea is there, or a root for this idea is there in Marx himself, and by the way, I mean, let us note in passing that Althusser notoriously, if I can speak once again about him, had a kind of irrational repulsion with respect to the description of the fetishism of commodity in Marx, which is very strange because, in a sense, this is where Marx comes closest to a kind of structuralist or structural understanding of the combination of representation and action or reality. But clearly, Althusser didn't want to buy that. And of course, and probably, I would say, one of the reasons had to do with his idea that you should describe ideology as a separate instance. I mean, something that is not deducible from the economic or the social form itself. Now, that leads me to a tentative answer. What is not there explicitly in Marx is the idea that you need a discourse in order to produce that automaticity. This is what the kind of phenomenological description I was briefly sketching a moment ago is alluding to, that capitalism at the end has produced the discourse, the kind of overwhelming and universally expanded discourse that interpolates, not in the name of transcendental values, but in the name of utility and immediate and exchange. Now, you could say, of course, that these are values, transcendent values as well, but what is more important is the everyday phenomenon. Now, to be honest, one has to add that if this is not explicitly in Marx, with the possible exception of his considerations on the juridical form. This is very much progressively introduced by later Marxists, and from this point of view, the one, no surprise, I find most interesting is the breakaway or heretic member of the Frankfurt school, that is Benjamin. Because Benjamin's idea of the aestheticization of market or commodity relations is, in fact, a very powerful description of the additional discourse through which capitalism produces its own automaticity. On the second point, and quickly, it's of course on purpose that I didn't use the category science, because the category science, in its traditional use, at least in Marxism, is very strictly or very rigidly combined with an antithesis between science and ideology in general, similar to the realm of truth and the realm of error, or the access to the real, the pure access to the real in a sense, and the realm of imagination on the other sense. So from this point of view, the discourse of science that Althusser did very much adopt or participate in, especially in his early phase, has a very strange and problematic symmetry with the discourse, I would say, of utopia or the spirit of utopia in Bloch, or the messianicity without messianism that Derrida proposed, because the two gestures are symmetrical. On the one side, they are always, in a sense, based on the idea of the scheme of the, I would say, way out, of the eruption of the other, except in one case, the other is the real, and in the other case, the other is the future, or the future in excess, or the possibilities in excess within the future. So I think that this is, in fact, perhaps necessary form. The justification of political practices, but it's theoretically problematic. So what we need is a theory, but not necessarily a science. And therefore, also what we need is to bring back, to reverse, in a sense, Marx's 11th thesis on Feuerbach. Move from interpretation into transformation. I would say bring back interpretation into transformation itself. And therefore, of course, address the question of what kind of difference or differential can be introduced into interpretation itself. So for that kind of reasons, I would tentatively prefer a defense of theory rather than a vindication of science. Mm-hmm. Speak loud, because my ears are extremely deaf.
Thank you for your lecture. You have ended up with the notion of absolute capitalism.
Yes.
And you have said that the neoliberalism is the most powerful ideology of today, if I understood it well. But aren't we facing a kind of withdrawal of neoliberalism from the role of the hegemonic discourse and ideology? Even the experts of International Monetary Fund have written the article that neoliberalism is wrong, and aren't we facing the rise of very strong ideologies of nationalism, racism, and
Absolutely.
Xenophobia all over the world?
Nationalism of?
Xenophobia.
Oh, xenophobia. Why do you believe that neoliberalism would be opposed to xenophobia? I mean, that's compatible. But I understand your point. I'm not extremely, yes, I did use the category neoliberalism, but I used it in a very broad sense. And in fact, what I had in mind was rather something like what the discourse about neoliberalism is in fact referring to is an advent or an emergence of something I tentatively call absolute capitalism. Instead of absolute capitalism, you might say self-referential capitalism. Or you might say a capitalism that has reached a stage in which each and every factor is not only commodified, but in a sense financialized, that is, evaluated as a financial asset. So in my opinion, this is not a discourse, or this is not or in any case, this is not something that depends on this or that orientation of economic theory as a discourse of experts, which of course, as we can see these days, is fluctuating between alternative strategies. But it's, yes, I remain very much a Marxist in that sense. It's a social form, or it's a social structure. So what the debates we have inside the IMF in this moment, of course, I find them very interesting, very revealing. They provoke reactions, denials, corrections. They are circular, of course, in many respects, because they, for example, when you read in the last paper that has by Jonathan Oster and his colleagues, that if inequalities are developing beyond or a certain proportion or amount, this becomes harmful for economic growth itself. You are not, of course, stepping out of the communist, what? I trapped myself. Of the economic orthodoxy. The category growth remains the absolute reference. You're just suggesting that there are different strategies and that the instability. The enormous instability of the current financial systems makes, I'd say, the governance of the system increasingly difficult and perhaps conflictual. So I will gladly abandon to you a category neoliberalism as a name for the economic system in which we live to today. I'm not very fond of that, in fact. But absolute capitalism is a problematic notion too. I used it essentially to explain, which has been already announced several times in history, of course, that every form of economic organization and exploitation of labor or human capacities in the world today is now entirely capitalist in its structure. So you no longer have the combination of different modes of production that occupy the whole period of transition. Now, whether this is compatible with xenophobia and nationalism is, in my view, not even a serious question, because the answer immediately visible is yes. It's yes. I mean, not really. The more serious question would be whether nationalism and xenophobia are functional to the working of absolute or globalized capitalism. And here, of course, but I don't ask you to take me at my word. I mean, I have a principal answer that it is not functional. That is, that the effects or consequences, and add to that the religious conflicts in today's world, of course, may very well and probably are bound to create problems and contradictions, in fact, for the governance of the global economic system, which have no guarantee, for which there is no guarantee that they can be controlled. But this is only one side of the broad question of the contradictions of absolute capitalism. Because what I'm saying here is not this is the end of history. The perfect, I said self-referential, but I did not say self-regulated mechanism. You might ask me, where is the ecological problem in your picture? So from this point of view, there we would have to develop a complete other discourse, and this would be probably all the more important because some of the ideologies in the political sense of the term that are bound to emerge and that are already there, in fact, in today's world are not only about the nation or the cultures or the values of the market as opposed to the values of communities and religious solidarities. They're also about the planet and the way and the way of life, and this is largely unpredictable. But what is not unpredictable, of course, is the intensification or the growing of tensions between the capitalization of say natural resources, and the violence of the conflicts that this capitalization is bound to produce.
You spoke about the possibility of emerging of a final ideology of capitalism, which would be a kind of a political discourse of utility, but is it possible to create a political ideology with an universal traits?
Universal traits.
Universal traits.
Yes.
Inside system with internal contradiction as capitalism is.
There.
I don't know if it.
Go ahead.
Possible at all.
I'm not sure I Well, you'll tell me if I'm on the right track in understanding your question. There's a formal level which has to do with, seems to me, the last part of your statement, whether the production of universalistic or universal ideological discourses is compatible with real contradictions of the system. And I would say not only it is compatible, but it is exactly their function. I mean, what makes the universality of any ideological discourse is essentially, it's not just the fact that it is adopted everywhere. It's not the extensive meaning of the idea of universality. It's the intensive meaning that is more important, namely precisely the idea of overcoming something like a contradiction or an internal conflict. So the ideology of human rights typically was that, and it's not away, it's still useful in different camps, on different sides. I called it tentatively the civic bourgeois a form of universalism. It's essentially a way to overcome certain conflicts and contradictions, and in order to overcome them, you have to acknowledge them in some sense. So the next question would be, and that takes us to the beginning of your point, whether the discourse of utility is potentially universalistic in that sense. And my answer is yes. I mean, utility is one of the most powerful signifiers, if you like, or values on which to base or from which to produce a universalistic discourse, which means, of course, that there will be competing ways of applying it and allowing it. So you may interpret growth or perpetual or steady growth in terms of utility, not only the utility of capital itself, but the utility of the population, the utility of life. And of course, you may object to growth. That's typically a kind of ecological discourse in the name of utility or use value. So here, the differential of utility and use value is, I believe, increasingly becoming a highly sensitive ideological point. I even tend, but I don't want to be dismissing that discourse, that the debate on use value and utility is more important in a sense, or is politically even more crucial than the debate about community, commonality, and the common. And then the second reason I see for that, it's a Spinozistic reason, if you like, is that utility or use and usefulness, so that's a whole series of terms. Of course, there's certain plasticity that we have to discuss here, is a notion, I'm tempted to say a signifier or a word, that interpolates subjects, to speak like Althusser, not only and perhaps not essentially at the level of political programs, ideological constructions in the political sense and discursive sense of the terms, for or against the IMF's discourse, for or against the World Social Forum, it's in bad state today, but perhaps not finished, on the other side. But it interpolates individuals at the level of the primary process, that is how they understand their own everyday life. And this is very much what Spinoza, who in this respect is not only great utilitarian but also a theorist in a sense of utilitarianism, would express in his description of ethical life. What individuals stake is the increasing capacity to act for themselves. That's a very powerful definition of utility, which shows that it's not purely a question of abstract discourses. So my answer, if I well understood your point, is yes on both sides, on both accounts. Universalism not only is compatible with conflict or contradiction, but it's a way of handling conflict. And second, utility is probably one of the most efficient, I would say, ideological signifiers in history. Jana. Speak loud, Jana, because although I know,
have you're pointing to this symmetry between Marx's discourse of the end of ideologies,
yes,
and the liberal discourse of the end of
yes,
ideologies.
Yes.
And I just wanted to remark, it seems to me that what you mentioned here is something that Althusser already in his periodization of Marx was in a sense predicting, right? Like, the criticism of the early Marxist work,
yes,
saying that, you know, the
yes,
contradictions,
yes,
that are presented,
yes,
in those works,
yes,
precisely,
yes,
the way, you know, to the
predominance, yes,
of a non-Marxist or anti-Marxist
discourse. I agree.
And so I wonder whether we could go that far as saying that it was maybe the left's focus. On
it was maybe the...
Maybe the European left's focus on the undissolved contradictions of the early Marx that led to this, you know, predominance of the discourse at the end of ideologies.
That's a very good question. I will not start a full discourse, but I agree with you. I mean, my first reaction to that is, there's a very sensitive issue in that, which I'm not hasting to conclude about, which has to do with the extent to which it's I'm not sure you like that, but it's a deconstructive proposition. It's the extent to which Marx's discourse is a bourgeois discourse. Marx's discourse about the development of productive forces, Marx's discourse about revolution, and Marx's discourse about revolutions. I'm more and more impressed by the fact that Kozelek, to whom I referred a moment ago, when he asked the question of the future past, in fact opened a devastating situation, or produced a devastating situation for Marxism itself, because we are permanently wondering whether such notions as revolution, communism, class struggle, and so on, are in fact internal reversals of the bourgeois discourse itself. This is, but I'm not hasting to say yes, because that would be, in a sense, to adopt a kind of deterministic understanding of that history. That would be to rule out from the beginning the idea that internal conflicts within the bourgeois discourse, the one that was produced by essentially the democratic revolutions and the industrial revolution can be, and perhaps and probably must be, in excess with respect to their own semantic, I would say, original site. And this is, in a sense, what I would reproach to my friend Wallerstein, because he puts Marxism more or less with socialism in general as one a variety of the three ideologies. And the question is not, in a sense, clarified like that, of where he stands himself, and whether, in a sense, he borrows from Marxism something that makes it possible not only to repeat or reiterate, but theorize and transform the bourgeois discourse itself. So that's a tension within Marxism, but I think you're absolutely right to ask the question. And second, quick answer, returning to Althusser, of course, one of the driving forces, I would say, of Althusser's critique in the early 60s, as we know, was his conviction, his perception, I mean, I'm tempted to say, that something from within Marxism had in the end produced a convergence with the dominant liberal or discourse itself. Only the important thing, and I think here it's important to return to the conjuncture, is not reduce that element to humanism. Mm-hmm. It's not humanism alone that would be meaningful from that point of view. It's the typical combination of economicism, or technocratism, if you like, and humanism. And this is why also I find it interesting, because of your subject, to return to the conjuncture of the 60s. So I try to examine the ideological conjuncture of the time. And that's why I quote Burnham, and I quote the ideology of the convergence of the industrial systems, etc., because this points, it seems to me, at the fact that was prompting Althusser, namely, we have a combination of, you say economism or economicism?
Economism.
You have a combination of economism and humanism, in fact, on both sides, even if it does not work exactly in the same words and the same way. Althusser was always fond of quoting, and that, of course, was against the grain of current debates in the communist movement itself, formulas from Stalin himself, which would show that Stalin was a great humanist, and the main formulas came and from a at the time famous discourse from 1935. This is not any year, of course. It's the achievement of collectivization and planification in its first form, and of course it's the moment of the great deportations, and in fact the equivalent of genocide on the side of the Soviets. I mean, the millions deported to camps and all that, in the name of what? In the name of, title of Stalin's great talk, man, the most precious capital. So the most important thing are not the machines, but the humans. And so he's the first theorist, in a sense, of the idea, one of the first theorists of human capital. When I read Gary Becker years later, discussing with François Hebel and so on, and he says, you take me to be a dry economist, etc. I am a humanist. I mean, my intention is to explain how a transformation of economic structures can work for the well-being, and not only the well-being, but the assertion of the absolute value of the human. Except the instrument is not planning, but it's generalizing the market. So it's the same binarity that returns and returns. And so I'm not saying that Althusser had understood all that, but I think that he was not wrong, to say the least, when pointing at this typical coupling, you know, and binarism. And if we want to justify, to some extent, his critique of humanism, we should never forget the other side. I mean, that is the key. So if that is what you have in mind, I very much agree with you.
Okay, I think we'll have to pause there and give Etienne a break and continue the discussion throughout the day. So let's thank Etienne again for
Thank you.